Hey folks, it's Esmeralda again, and you noticed the title of this segment. It's gonna pretty much, I have these series uploaded on my End Times Deliverance channel. I try to upload it on Isaiah chapter 15, I think, verses 1 through 9, but it didn't go, but that's okay. At least it's on this channel. And you guys will get to see what's what. Excuse me, you guys, for a moment. Could you give me plastic bags? I'm cleaning my hamster's cage out. Plastic bags, please.
Okay.
Leave the wheel there. Sorry, you guys. Anyway, the reason I'm making this wrap-up segment is because I wanted to, sorry about the distraction of the plastic bags, guys. I wanted to go over with you all on what it takes for being delivered of an incubus spirit. What it takes to be delivered from an incubus spirit. Now, look at my prior videos on the End Times Deliverance. It'll go into what is considered a legal right for them to enter. Okay? So when you're being delivered from an incubus spirit, the legal right has to be identical. First of all, the deliverance minister has to be free of any sin, confessing sins, going through repentance, going through correction, so the sin can be washed away by the blood of the Lamb. Same thing for the victim. Once that is taken care of, then you can proceed with the deliverance. Now, keep in mind that some, all demons, will try to refer back on sins to call it out against you that you've already confessed, or sins that you may have not confessed. That's why it's important to make sure that you're completely sin-free when getting prepared for the deliverance. This goes for the the victim, and this also goes for the not only just the victim, but the deliverance minister conducting the deliverance. Okay, if a deliverance minister lays hands on the victim, and a deliverance minister has a lot of sin in their life, another way you can form ungodly soul ties is if the deliverance minister lays hands on the victim and when he lays hands on the victim, what happens is that whatever demons that the deliverance minister has gets transferred to the victim, thereby forming a very ugly demonic concoction. Just want to let you guys know that. Now, that's why it's important for the deliverance minister to be completely repentant of all sins. Not one spot on the garment of the deliverance minister. So that way, when he does God uses him to do the deliverance, the victim can be completely free. So the victim and the deliverance minister must both be completely free of sin, because the Holy Spirit can only use a purified vessel during a deliverance session. The Holy Spirit cannot use an unclean vessel, meaning the deliverance minister, okay? So, same thing in the situation, if a deliverance is going on, and let's say the victim has sin, and the deliverance minister, they can transfer those demons to each other via an ungodly soul tie. Ladies and gentlemen, let's also talk about if the person is, the victim is completely repentant of sins and a deliverance minister isn't. If the deliverance minister lays hands on that righteous person, again, he can transfer ungodly soul ties to that particular person. Although it would be an illegal entry for those demons to be transferred to that righteous individual, to a certain degree, because that righteous individual is choosing to have that deliverance minister help him or her. And if that righteous individual knows that that deliverance minister needs to be completely free of all sins and doesn't remind the deliverance minister, then whatever demons transfers from the the deliverance minister to the victim, okay, would technically have legal rights, because it is like the victim's giving that deliverance minister the choice. That giving those demons a choice by not telling the deliverance minister or reminding the deliverance minister, look, I'm not doing this deliverance until I know that you're completely free of sin, because I don't want your demons transferring to me. I'm dealing with my own stuff right now. I hope you guys get the point. And it's vice versa for the deliverance minister as well. Deliverance minister that is righteous cannot lay hands on a victim to deliver them that is in sin, and it hasn't confessed their sins and been completely freed of sins before the deliverance. So bottom line is, for the deliverance to be a success, the deliverance minister must be completely freed of all sin, without spot, without blemish, so God can use a clean, purified vessel, being a deliverance minister, free of sins, to deliver the victim. Let's make things clear, ladies and gentlemen. Nothing's done without the soul strength and power of the Holy Spirit. Let's make that very, very clear. Now, when we got that said and done, when you are seeking help, okay, like I said, make sure that deliverance minister is righteous with God. Make sure that deliverance minister, and this is this you will find by consulting Jesus Christ, make sure that you're completely repentant of your sins to get prepared for the deliverance. You know that God only hears the cries of the righteous. If you are in sin, he's not going to hear your cries. You got to keep confessing your sins, going through the corrections so they can be washed away by the blood of the Lamb, and repenting of your sins. You want to also make sure that that deliverance minister is not only free from sin, but doesn't, you know, that deliverance minister is living righteous by God. Because you have a lot of ministers that let's just face it, are not. Okay? When you get to the heart of the deliverance, okay, you start doing it, when the Lord starts doing a deliverance on you, working through the path, through the deliverance minister in a mighty way, and all the sins are confessed and they're repented for, and both of you being the victim and the minister are free from sin, you can now move forward with the deliverance. There are certain steps that have to be taken. The deliverance minister has to say prayers of protection to the Lord Jesus Christ to protect you and your family members, everyone in the house, himself, your finances, those you come in contact with, your job, everything, because these demons will retaliate in any way and destroy whatever you have in your life. They have to command that these demons do not retaliate in any way, shape, or form. They have to command that these demons remain silent during the deliverance and do not manifest or interfere. Have to ask the Lord Jesus Christ to remove all evil agents within a 1,000-mile radius. Okay? Also have to bind the spirits within the victim, outside of the victim. Bind the strong man first. Bind all the evil spirits within the victim, the subordinates. Bind all communication and power lines that the demons inside may be trying to make with each other inside the victim and outside of the victim. And like I said, when the Lord removes all the spirits around, that'll take care of that as well. But you want to say to remove the spirit or evil spirits around, and also cut off communication lines between the demons within and the demons from within and outside of the victim. You also want to say that you command that the demons be detached from every part of the victim. Their blood, their mind, body, heart, soul, spirit, their organs, you name it. When these demons enter a victim, they start to build a kingdom within the victim. You want to crush the kingdom by commanding it in Jesus' name. Break all counterfeit vines and trees. Break their hexes, vexes, bondages to the victim. Ungodly chains, ungodly strongholds, soul ties, curses, generational curses. You want to break all of that. Any influence the enemy has on the victim, you want to break that. You want to break the enemy off the victim completely. All generational curses got to be broken as well. by the blood of the Lamb. That's very possible. You also want to make sure that once that is broken, okay, you want to render those entities powerless. You also want to get to the heart of the matter, and that's breaking the legal rights, the bonds, the bondages. You know, let the demons know that the victim gave his or her life to Jesus Christ. So break those legal rights, break the contracts, ungodly binds that demon has to the victim, ungodly contracts, ungodly chains, if you will. You want to break that. All legal rights to be severed. Once that's severed, okay, the demon has no power to stay in the victim anymore. This is when the demon will start, or demons, to fight you even harder. Sometimes they will go dormant. You want to make sure, okay, that you have a very high discernment with the Lord Jesus Christ, because the Holy Spirit will let you know if that demon is still present and is trying to go dormant. Because there are a lot of pastors or ministers that do not have a lot of discernment, and then they stop the deliverance, thinking it's a success. And then come later on, the victim's contacting the pastor again, saying, hey, this demon is back, wreaking havoc on my life. Meaning the demon will come back with a vengeance, more stronger presence than before. So you have to make sure that that demon is not present in the victim at all. And you need discernment for that, because they can go dormant. These demons will also try to trick you. They will try to fake a deliverance, make you think that the victim, excuse me, you guys. They'll try to make you think that the victim is completely freed when the victim is not. Okay? What else can I tell you guys? Because very important you know this.
So cute.
Okay. Sorry, my hamster's so cute. Love animals. Anyway, you guys, she's happy because her cage is clean. I have to clean some more animals' cages. Anyway, because I have a lot of guinea pigs and hamsters. Anyway, going back to the topic at hand, you just want to make sure that demon is not present. You need the Holy Spirit for that. You need the Holy Spirit for this entire thing, because nothing moves without the Holy Spirit's mighty power and strength. Okay? Arrange it back neatly, okay?
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, a deliverance session can take more than one time, depending on the severity of the case. So, the deliverance minister could be praying for hours, and then we'll have to come back again. Okay? Once the legal rights are broken, the demon has to be forced out. Here's what I also wanted to tell you about demons that are interesting, or a lot of people don't really know. They will try to bind themselves to the victim, to the outside of the spirit. Okay? They will try. If they bind themselves to the outside of the spirit, and I've seen this happen firsthand, okay? The victim can become partially conformed to the demon's physical appearance. I've seen it happen, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, you guys, I've seen it happen. They will try to do that. Sometimes they'll try to do a permanent binding spell, meaning that they will try to physically bind themselves to that person's spirit. Now, God forbid if that person blasphemes God, and I'm hoping that doesn't happen, then instead of the whole, you know how when you blaspheme God, the Holy Spirit departs? Every time the Holy Spirit departs, a human being departs their inner spirit, a demon will take up residence. Bible talks about how when a person's, let's say when a person is delivered from demons, okay, and let's say, for example, that house is swept clean, meaning that the house is swept clean, that demon will come back to try to find its original resting place. So, house meaning swept clean, that particular scripture means two things. One, that when a person sins again, that demon will come back with 7 each of their own. That's one part. The other part that scripture means is that the house is swept clean, meaning that the Holy Spirit is no longer present because that particular individual blasphemed the Most High God. So a demon will take up residence. When a demon resides in a person's spirit, that demon over time will conform that individual to its physical appearance. Look at Beyonce. If you look at her, you have to have spiritual eyes to see and hear. She looks just like the demon that's conformed to her. Okay? Or the demon, the demon that she's conformed to. Correction. All right? The other thing I wanted to talk to you guys about is that I know I'm giving you like a crash course, but there's a lot of people being attacked by these spirits and they need to know this information. Okay? A demon can possess a person mildly, and mildly means pretty much, mildly means like the demon's influencing your actions, but you're still you, you know? They're still influencing your actions. That's mildly. There will be some personality changes in you, but not too severely where a person might not know. You would have to have the Holy Spirit in you, and I'm talking about full discernment, to know if a person that's mildly possessed is off spiritually. You know, like they're not being themselves. That's one way. Another way, I mean, there's another form of possession, which is medium possession, where the demon's influencing your actions, but is more in control. So sometimes that demon will, not all the time, but sometimes that demon will take control of your actions. Sometimes you may have, it'll take fully control of you, meaning you may have black spells, meaning blackouts, where you don't remember what you're doing. Or you find yourself in a place and you don't know how you got there. Or people say you did this or that and you don't remember. Also, the personality changes are more noticeable. You're more aggressive, depressed, sexually active. You might even be eating more. You might be depressed. You will be acting in a way that is opposite to your normal personality, and other people will this time notice it even more. Okay? Wanted to point that out to you as well. Another thing that I wanted to point out to you, in addition, that you need to know, is that you will be, like I said, more aggressive. In medium possessive stages, you can take on supernatural abilities, such as superhuman strength, psychic abilities, and also being an empath, and other unusual abilities that, you know, like I said, it could be psychic, it could be an empath. Psychic is when demons can tell when the future is going to happen. That's false. The only one that knows when the future is going to happen is Jesus Christ. Demons cannot read the minds of the righteous. They do not know their thoughts. They can read the minds of sinners. They know their thoughts. Because that particular individual that's in sin, demons only know sin. So demons would be able to read their thoughts. Okay? The only one that knows the future and what's going on is Jesus Christ. And that's the bottom line. What else can I tell you guys that you need to know? Full possession. So I'm giving you like a crash course, okay? So you know what to look for. And you can use the Holy Spirit to guide you the rest of the way. This is the Holy Spirit speaking through me, okay? This is not my strength, not my knowledge. It's God's knowledge. God gave me these revelations. When you are fully possessed, that means that that person is not even home. That's the demon taking full control of the person, full manifestation. Because in medium possession is partial manifestation, and in mild possession, there's very little manifestation. But in full possession, there's full manifestation of the demon. The person has full strength. Some of their physical appearances can change as well, because they're being conformed to that demon. Mm-hmm. Again, assuming that that demon has not...
You said the person has full strength.
Thank you for correcting me. Well, I was correct. Mm-hmm. I was correct. The demon will give them full strength, full everything.
Oh,
that's correct. Really? Yes. Wow. No, let me finish the teaching.
Okay.
I'm very serious about this, guys, because people are being attacked by demons every day. So, in full manifestation, a demon will fully manifest in that individual. That person will have superhuman strength at a full capacity. That person will not only have superhuman strength at a full capacity, that particular person will also not be themselves. That demon will be in complete control, not the individual. Just so you understand. In mild possession, the person may have very few physical characteristics of the demon. In medium, they'll have more. And in full, they'll have a lot more. If the demon is physically conformed, if the demon is residing in a person's spirit, again, let's say if the person, let's assume a person blasphemed God, and I'm not wishing that, then that person would become fully conformed to the demon. Just so you all know. Okay? Now, with that being said, okay, the reason why I was telling you about this, because it applies to incubus spirits. You have to go through the same format when a deliverance is taking place. Okay?
The charge is right next to you.
When a demon is being delivered, I'm sorry, guys, let me correct that. When an individual is being delivered, the deliverance methods, the mechanics, applies to an incubus spirit as well. Incubus spirit is known as a succubus is known as like I said, a spiritual spouse in most cultures. Okay, and they will reside, like I said, they literally live in the victim. Okay, so although I told you in my prior video that it could be hard to get rid of an incubus or succubus spirit, it could be hard, but it's not impossible. All right? It's not impossible to get rid of them. Okay? Anything is possible through the blood of the Lamb.
What?
And I also wanted to let you know that anything is possible. Anything is possible. The mighty name of Jesus Christ. Because those things hate it when you use the name of the Father, you know, Jesus Christ. They hate it. Ladies and gentlemen, with that being said, if there are any of you at all, okay? Any of you going through this, please do not delay on getting deliverance. These demons induce dreams. They can be nightmarish, night terrors, everything. Okay? Do not hesitate on getting delivered. The Lord Jesus Christ will send a minister that is right in Him your way to help you. I hope these series and these segments have helped you. Have blessed you. I hope that in the mighty name of God that you find the peace that you're looking for, that you are free from this spirit if you are being afflicted by the spirit. As I said in my prior videos, do not delay on getting deliverance. Do not, and I repeat, do not wait on it. If you are being attacked, you want to challenge these attacks. Do not give the spirit any type of inclination or indication that you enjoy these attacks, that you want these attacks to continue, you must challenge them. Because if you continue these attacks and you let the spirit rape you, and I'm going to call it rape, I'll call it what it is, okay, that's defiling the temple of God, which is the body, you, the Holy Spirit. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to end this video here. Okay? I pray that Jesus Christ watches over all of you. I pray that you stay in the name of God, name of the Lord Jesus Christ, meaning that Jesus Christ is God. Because, again, these things want nothing but your demise. I hope this video helps someone. If you are going through anything, please message me. I will be happy to help. God bless. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. I wasn't expecting to be discussing this topic anytime soon. I've talked about it before, incubus and succubus spirits. But I had a recent request, I'm not going to mention any names, about someone that's going through these types of attacks. I prayed to Jesus about it, and I felt led by the Holy Spirit to explain to those that haven't seen my videos and what I've spoken about these spirits exactly what they are. Okay? First, I want to let you know that I got attacked by incubus spirits a few years back. And it was a time that I was going through a rough spot in my life. I never had any struggles with lust. Okay? But the fact that at that time I thought about lust, because the Bible says if you lust in your heart, you did it. So therefore, I thought about it and it started to brew in my heart. The incubus spirits latched on and gained legal rights to me. I'm going to tell you something about my experience so you can understand. I'll tell you what the symptoms are. When you attack by incubus spirits, first of all, they're talked about in the Bible. I'm not going to get into it, but reference Genesis chapter 19. These entities can take physical form. You need to know that. Okay? They're known in most cultures as spiritual husband for incubus, spiritual wife for succubus. These spirits do have homosexual tendencies. The incubus spirit is also homosexual spirits. So meaning they will attack male. They're bisexual spirits. They will attack females and males. Succubus spirits are spirits of homosexuality. In other words, they're lesbian spirits too. So they attack females. They also can be bisexual. So they'll attack male and female. Some of the attacks will start as sleep paralysis, where you will not be able to move. Some people who said that they've experienced partial sleep paralysis, where they feel like this weight on their chest. They feel like something's choking them. They hear like a buzzing in their ear. You can Google you can search YouTube for sleep paralysis attacks. There's many, many testimonies out there, so I won't get into that. Some individuals, these spirits come to you. Some of them, a lot of times they'll come to you in your sleep. They'll appear as somebody that someone that is sexually pleasing to your eye. They can appear as a former boyfriend, your current husband, wife. They can even appear as someone that you fantasize as your ideal man or woman. If you're a widow, they will appear as your dead husband, and the widow is going to think that she's sleeping with her actual husband, but it's a demon. It's not her husband. You know, when you die, you wake up in heaven or hell. And any demons that are roaming around can take on, a lot of them can take on the shapes of your relative, your family member, or friend. So incubus are also familiar spirits, because they can take on your husband's form, your wife's form. Succubus can take on if it's a man, it'll take on the form of what his wife looked like. Succubus spirits, the bisexual ones anyway, can take on the form of a man or a woman in shape, but their natural their natural appearance is a female, but they could take on, only the bisexual spirits of succubus can take on the shape of a man if it's attacking a woman, or take on the shape of a woman if it's attacking a man, or even vice versa. Could take on the when it's attacking a woman, it'll take on the appearance of a woman, or it'll just stay in its regular shape. But I'm just saying, these spirits are shapeshifters, okay? Succubus can shapeshift into a man or a woman, and the incubus can shapeshift, thank you. The incubus can shapeshift into a pleasing man, okay? And let me correct something. They can't shapeshift into a woman. They could shape into a man that's pleasing to a woman. If they're attacking a man, then that's when they can shape into a woman to be pleasing to that man, so those attacks can happen, or they'll just stay in their manly form. Going over to the succubus, when they attack a man, they appear in an appearance that's pleasing to the man. But if they're attacking a woman, they'll either stay in their womanly form and attack the woman, or they will appear as a man that's pleasing to the woman, so the attacks can commence. There you go. Some of them will attack in your sleep. So if you have wet dreams, that's a demonic spirit causing that. It's not natural, like many people say. They feed on your fear. They feed on your lust. They feed on any sin. They also will feed on your essence. So if you are having a sexual encounter with these demonic entities and you have an orgasm for a man or a woman, it'll feed off that. They feed off the semen of the man spiritually and the vaginal fluids of the woman spiritually. So the incubus will feed off of the woman, and the succubus will feed off the man. Again, depending on what type of spirits that they are, if they're heterosexual, bisexual, or homosexual. They can also be very violent. So the attacks can be from mild to violent. So they will start out mild. They will not always be mild, okay? They will start out mild, but over time, those attacks will get violent. So these demons, irregardless, are raping you. You may think, if you are being attacked, that the sex is pleasurable, but let me tell you something, it's doing more damage than good, because the more you have an encounter with these demons, it could be very dangerous for your health, because not only do they feed on sin and fear and lust, and through your sexual essence, they will also feed on your energy, your life force. And several encounters with these demonic spirits can be very life-threatening to you. Okay? These demonic entities, I want to make sure I didn't miss anything, because I have some notes on here. Just want to make sure that I did not miss nothing. These demonic entities can latch onto any sin to gain a legal right. And then they will tempt you to lust, because they are spirits of sexual perversion and sodomy. These entities, if they are attacking you, they become the primary demon, the dominant personality, the demonic gateway, or the demonic stronghold, which is in essence the same. If you give in to these demons willingly, you're giving it full legal right. Several things can keep that spirit there. If you have accursed objects in your house, if you as a person think about lust, you lust in the flesh, in your heart, that's a demonic gateway for those demonic spirits to come to you. Other demonic gateways, or other out demonic doorways, I should say, that those demons will get in, is if you lust, like I said, pornography, masturbation, sexual content in movies, magazines, books, and the like. If you're thinking about lust and sex, Bible says if you lust in your heart, you did it. So if you're sexually active, if you fornicated, in other words, if you slept with someone outside of the covenant, the godly covenant of marriage between man and woman, those are demonic doorways, okay? Other demonic doorways, obviously, if you practice witchcraft, any type of black magic, any disobedience to God is a demonic doorways for these demons to enter through, okay? Another way
another way that I'm going to mention to you as another example is forming godly soul ties, and that's through fornication outside, again, of the covenant of marriage. So anybody you sleep with, they might be dealing with demons in their life. That spirit, the incubus, could transfer through that ungodly soul tie. These are also spirits of transference, meaning that it could be a generational spirit. This generational spirit could pass from one generation to the other. It could be via a contract, via a legal right. Also, via the fact that maybe you were promised to that demon by your ancestor or family member. The other way it can pass through is if, okay, your generation is unclean. So, for example, if your great-grandmother had this incubus spirit and her daughter is unclean, if she gives birth to her daughter, according to the Bible, that's an unclean seed until that woman repents and becomes righteous with God. That spirit can latch on to her, okay? That spirit can go from generation to generation until a righteous seed is born, until a righteous seed comes forth. So let's say there's a family member that demon tries to latch onto, okay? And that family member becomes saved, confesses their sins, Jesus Christ, repents, accepts Jesus Christ, the Lord and Savior, lives for the Lord, then that generational curse will break, okay? So I'm giving you a couple of examples here. Another thing I wanted to mention to you is that these demonic entities will even try to, you know, gain, like I said, these examples that I gave you is what gives it legal rights to you. These are also territorial spirits. So if you have accursed objects in your house, that could keep the demon hanging around. Okay. If you are righteous with God, these demons are known to force themselves on a righteous person illegally. That's an illegal right. The deliverance is much easier because, you know, that person, that righteous person is not even living in sin. So the deliverance is easier. The spirit pretty much gets kicked out. Okay. Now, if you are in sin, okay, the sin strengthens the spirit's presence. You know, the sin, any kind of sin will feed it. Like I said, when you have sex with it, will feed it. Your life force, orgasms feed it. It'll strengthen its presence. That so much so that you will notice disturbances around your house. Things will be moving. Your stuff can be missing. You will notice objects moving. You will hear banging noises. You will hear noises. You'll hear voices. Doors slamming, windows opening, you name it. You'll hear it. Okay, almost like a poltergeist. I mean, it's a poltergeist. It can be a poltergeist type spirit as well. You will also hear loud banging sounds. What I want to make you understand is that these spirits can attack any day, any time of the day. So you could be sitting at work and you'll feel stimulation in your general area because that's how the attacks usually start. You'll notice like flutters in your general area. And then it'll start to get more intensified until you orgasm, okay? You will also notice, like I said, the attacks will be throughout the day. And then come night, the attacks will pick up. The attacks will pick up at 12 midnight, especially during a demonic hour, which is from 3 to 4. So the demonic activity is more strong when the spiritual realms are at its thinnest, which is from 12 a.m. to about 3. I want to say 3 to 4 in the morning. Okay? The spirit will not let you sleep. Every time you try to sleep, it'll mess with your organs because it does reside inside of your body. You will notice your organs shifting. You will notice pain in your abdomen. You'll feel little butterflies. You'll feel flutters. You'll feel it moving throughout your body. It will not let you sleep. Sometimes it'll make your legs jolt, your joints jolt. It'll make you jerk, like your arm can move without you moving it. Your leg, your arm, your whatever. You will not be able to sleep. Okay. I'm gonna give you my testimony. Hopefully, I'll be able to cover it in this segment. But it'll also make sounds in your house. It'll make loud banging noises every time you try to fall asleep. It'll make loud banging noises. you will be sleep deprived. This spirit will attack you. It wants you to be like so tired, so exhausted. You will not be able to fight off the attacks by using the name of Jesus. Okay. What else do I want to tell you? When you seek help, you attempt to seek out help, it will become more violent and it will become upset and it will try to stop you from seeking out help. You have to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You have to confess your sins, repent, get baptized in water, go through correction so the sins can be washed away with the blood of the Lamb. These spirits hate it when you use the name of Jesus. Sometimes these incubus will attack in droves, meaning you might have an incubus spirit that'll come to you for a few months, right? And then it'll leave and another one will take its place. The reason why another one will take its place is because the sin in your life is still present. Plus, there's that demonic residue. Another demon could sense when another one was just there. So to that demon, it'll view as a demonic presence in your life as a normality. It'll think that you are accustomed to those types of visits, those types of attacks, and then it'll carry on the attacks. Don't ever believe when a demon tries to say that they're not evil. You don't want a relationship with these things. They're evil. Their only intent is to consume your soul. These demonic spirits do not care about you. Now, I'm going to tell you something about the sexual pleasure. The sexual pleasure is highly addictive. I've been where you're at. It can be highly addictive, yet painful. They will cause you an intense amount of pain in your genital area. These demons, incubus spirits, will make a woman barren. A succubus spirit will make a man barren. In other words, a woman will not be able to get pregnant. If it's a man, the succubus will make the man not be able to impregnate his wife. These are very territorial spirits. They're also very jealous. So, like I said, in most cultures, these spirits are known as spiritual spouse. So if you have a demon like this that is attacking you, and you have a boyfriend or a girlfriend, or if you're a guy, you have a girlfriend or wife, okay? She could be in potential danger because these spirits are very jealous. Same thing with a woman. If you have a husband, or if you're not married, you have a boyfriend or fiance, or they are very jealous. An incubus spirit can be very jealous. And your significant other could be in potential danger. Significant other mean man with a woman or woman with a man in the ways of God. You know, holy matrimony. You've got to be very careful. As far as the symptoms of these spirits are concerned, you will notice, this is how you know when you're being attacked by an incubus spirit, okay? You will have these sexual urges, unusually high sexual arousal, sexual drive. Now, I understand that some humans can have a healthy sex drive, can have a high sex drive, which is fine. You know, that happens. But it's now normal to have a high sex drive for hours, even days. Non-stop. Days, a high sex drive. Always aroused. Orgasmic episodes. In other words, you could have an orgasm without any sexual stimulation, without you even thinking about sex. All of a sudden, you have an orgasm. Like I said, one of the other symptoms is that it's very highly addictive. These demons, let me tell you something. They're very skilled at sex. They know how to touch a woman in ways that a man can't. And a succubus knows how to touch a man in the ways that a woman can't. That's why when people are afflicted by these spirits, they have a hard time giving up the sex because it's so addictive. They also have a hard time being with a human again because it's so addictive. They say that sex with a demon is better than a human. Let me tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. It's not. It's a very painful experience. And this is me telling you this. Yes, at first, it could be very addictive, but it is very painful. It's extremely painful. They mess with your organs and everything. These demons will give you pleasure, but at the same time, they give you pain. And it's not worth the price that you're going to pay in hell. It's not worth the price of losing Jesus Christ over these demons. Another symptom you will notice is that you will have wet dreams consistently. It's not normal to have wet dreams. I don't care what they say out there. It's not. When you are fantasizing about a man or a woman's fantasy, when you are fantasizing about anybody other than your husband or wife, that invites this demon. You cannot look at your husband or wife in a sexual, lustful manner. It is against God. That will invite those demons. God says if a man looks at a woman, he's already lusted in his heart. Ladies and gentlemen, as I told you, these demons are very territorial spirits. If you are going through this situation, please do not delay in getting help. Okay? Do not delay in seeking help, because the more you delay, the more that demonic presence is going to become more strong and more apparent in your house. And the more, power and influence it will have over you. Understand that Jesus Christ is Lord. Anything is possible with the blood of the Lamb. The other thing I wanted to also explain to you guys is that you might feel hopeless. You might feel like, why isn't Jesus helping me? Look at your life. If you are being attacked by a demon, look at your life. Evaluate how you're living. Are you living right by Jesus? If you have one spot of sin, that'll invite those demons in. Accursed objects in your house can also do that. It can bind those demons there, give them a legal right to be in your house. That's a territorial spirit. Incubus spirits can be hard to get rid of, but again, nothing is impossible with the blood of the Lamb. Can they be eradicated? Yes. But depending on your situation, it could take time. So if you have so much sin in your life that it's hard to get past it, if you are harboring unforgiveness for someone, that can keep that spirit there, because unforgiveness is another gateway that these demons can enter through. Okay? These attacks are very real. My situation, this demon used to attack me and mess with my genital areas. I would feel it shifting throughout all of my organs. It will always mess with my organs. The spiritual spouse resides in you, and it will usually attack you at night. When an incubus spirit attacks a female or a succubus attacks a male, it views that person as its temple. You know that we're the temple of the Holy Spirit, not these demons, right? So these demonic spirits would view that person, the victim, as its temple that it has legal rights to. I'm also going to mention something else to you that you need to know, okay? When you willingly have sex with these demons, you consummate your union with them, meaning you have willful sex with these demons, you as an individual are inviting this demon in again, giving it full legal rights. So what that means is that this demon is laying claim to you. So when you willingly consummate with this demon, you are in effect agreeing to a demonic matrimonial contract with these incubus or succubus spirits, thereby solidifying the legal right it has on you. And then that demon will open a full stronghold in you, See, because when you think of when you sin, but you don't act on it, a partial stronghold is open. But when you fully sin, like giving into this demon willingly, having sex with it, unknowingly getting into a demonic matrimonial contract with this demon. In other words, basically marrying this demon in an unholy, ungodly union by having sex with it, you're giving it full legal rights and it's a full stronghold. Every time these incubus spirits has sex with a human being, they deposit more spirits into that individual. The more you lust, seven each of their own comes into you. Like it says in the Word of God. Ladies and gentlemen, remember the symptoms. If you have uncontrollable sexual urges, a high sex drive, you have uncontrollable orgasms, all you think about, it gets to the point that these orgasms and these sexual urges are taking control of your life, okay? If you feel continuous sensations down there in your area there, okay, you have wet dreams all the time, you have a high sex drive, you are being attacked by an incubus or a succubus, okay? Remember as well that every time these demons fornicate with you, they're planting seeds of perversion and lust. Also remember, each time they steal a piece of your soul. Okay? Like I said, if you have encounters with this demon, it could be dangerous to your health. Okay? These demons do not care about you. There are people out there that actually believe that they can have a relationship with these spirits. You cannot have a relationship with a demon, ladies and gentlemen. It's impossible. Okay? They do not care about your welfare or your well-being, ladies and gentlemen. I can't tell you how many deliverance cases I come across, okay? And the victim would say, well, it promised me this and that. And also, these demons can appear as an angel of light, like it says in the Bible. Oh, it appeared to me as an angel. And I hear just these excuses, I'm going to call them that, from the victims. They thought the demon was their wife or husband, to it appeared as an angel of light and it was in love with me. These demons do not have the capability of loving, ladies and gentlemen. They don't. Okay? You guys need to be very, very careful with these spirits. There's a reason why they've been cast into hell. They are sodomites. I want to make sure I didn't miss anything else. Again, look at the book of Genesis 19. If you are going through these attacks, you need to get a deliverance minister right away. Do not wait on it. I highly recommend you seek a deliverance minister. Do not wait on this. You will feel movements in your abdomen, in your stomach, in your legs. Okay? That's a common place that they like to hang out, especially the back. Remember what I told you? They can enter through the eyes. They can enter through the mouth, the nose, the back, even your front. These demons will even attempt to open your chakra. Believe it or not, that's the third eye, the counterfeit discernment. I've seen that happen. These demons can also come to you if they are summoned by you via rituals like black magic, witchcraft. It can also come that way. And witchcraft is a sin, so you not only be attracting an incubus spirit, but also spirits of the occult. And what other spirits you'll attract, because when you do witchcraft, you're opening up a doorway as well, so you can attract many demons. I've had subscribers. Another reason why I put this testimony up here. I mean, this. I put this up here for you, is because I've had subscribers email me telling me that they're experiencing these attacks and they need help. And I even get private emails from many, many folks that they need help. So they ask me to put this video up as a testimony for them. These attacks are very real. So if you think that people going through this are nuts and are crazy, then you're calling thousands of people crazy. So before you sit there and please don't get offended, but before you sit there and make snap judgments and run your mouth, go to God in prayer and ask him if what I tell you is true. These attacks are very real. And I get emails from people every day that they're going through these attacks. They don't know what to do. The demon's not letting them sleep. It's attacking them. It's throwing things around their house. It's wreaking havoc on their life. That's what these spirits do. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, take this to Jesus in prayer. And if you are going through these attacks, please, you need help. And get it quick. Don't wait. Hey everyone, it's been a while since I've been on here. I've been extremely busy doing a lot of stuff for the Lord. But one of the things that the Lord wanted me to bring to light is, if you notice the title of this broadcast, is Incubus, Succubus, Spirits Are Real Part 1. Because after doing an extensive amount of research, using the Word of God as my primary source, and looking at various testimonies across the country, and I'm going to leave you a link to those testimonies, there are a lot of people that are afflicted by this spirit, incubus and succubus. And I'm going to tell you in a moment what they are. Excuse me. There are people that wake up with wet dreams. It can be a female that's had a dream about making love to a guy, or a guy making love to a girl. And the dream is very lucid and very, very realistic. So real that you could feel every sensation, you could smell everything, you could, it's like you right there. That's how real it is. And when you wake up, oftentimes you find yourself still aroused. Okay? That's because that actually happened. You see, these beings can place you in like a trance-like state, in a dream state, if you will, making you think that you're dreaming, but all the while in the real world, in the physical, you are actually having sex with these beings. Now, I'm going to give you background information on what these beings are. This is going to be possibly a more than part one series, okay? Because I'm going to talk about the incubus and the succubus spirits so you know what they are. Now, the incubus spirits, before we go any further, it is a demon that induces it. These sex spirits, this incubus, can induce nightmares. Incubus means to induce a dream of some sort. So they can induce nightmares. Okay. Incubi goes far as back as 2400 BC. Goes far back, even beginning of that. If you look at the book of Genesis chapter 19. Sodom and Gomorrah was destroyed because of the fact of extensive homosexuality and sodomy and fornication. These spirits inspire that. These are spirits of lust, fornication, sexual perversion. They thrive on that. I'm going to get into more detail about these spirits. Like I said, this is possibly going to take more than one series. These particular demons are, like I said, you'll see reference of them in chapter 19 in the book of Genesis. I don't know if you remember, the book of Genesis talks about how the Lord sent two angels that took human bodies to warn the Sodomites of their impending destruction. And what happened was that the male residents actually tried to rape these two angels. Now, these are sex spirits that feed on your sexual energy when you're sleeping. That's how they sustain themselves, is through the sexual energy. It is rumor has it that if you have more than one sexual encounter with these beings, it can leave you exhausted. And, you know, even over a long period of time, eventual death, depending on your health. These beings do not give you satisfaction. They don't give, they might give you what you perceive as sexual ecstasy, but there's always pain behind it. They don't give you happiness. If anything, they destroy everything you have, your marriage, your home, your family. They prevent a woman from becoming barren, from becoming fertile. They basically make a woman's womb barren. They prevent her from having sexual relations with her husband. Because when you are in an active sexual encounter with these beings, it can be highly addictive because they give your body extreme sexual pleasure. I'm going to talk to you about these demons and I'm going to break it down to you because there are a lot of brothers and sisters in Christ that have brought it to my attention that they are experiencing these attacks and they don't know what to do. Or they're praying, but they still are being encountered by these spirits. Legend has it that incubi aim to impregnate women to bear a child. Incubi aim, yes, to impregnate women with seeds of lust. Incubi attack females sleeping. They prefer their victims to be sleeping. They are also known as spiritual husbands, especially if they come back to the victim again over a long period of time. They are known as spiritual husbands as well. They not only feed on the sexual sin, they can literally gain access. They can literally gain access to an individual via other sins. In other words, if the person has a stronghold of theft open, or if they have a stronghold of deception, lies, gluttony, okay, they can enter into that person's life via that stronghold. There are many ways a succubi or an incubi can actually gain access to you. It's via any sin, accursed objects in your house, using occult, using the occult, using black magic spells to summon one of these beings. I highly recommend against it. If you lust, pornography, if you cheat on your spouse, or if you think about sex on a consistent basis, if you think about lust, if you lust with the eyes, if you masturbate, I've done videos on sexual fornication. Check them out. It goes into detail about what sexual fornication is. I was giving you a little bit of background information leading up to these series. What I also wanted to let you know as well is that the incubi, like I said, incubus, appear to a woman in her sleep. These encounters can be violent, where the woman is beaten, raped, choked, slapped, or they can be mild, where she just gets extreme sexual pleasure, but it is still a danger. These spirits are very territorial. Once they attach themselves to a victim, it is hard to get rid of them. I'm going to tell you about these spirits, and then I'm going to tell you what you can do for deliverance from them. These spirits can linger around, especially if you have any unconfessed sins. They can use any sin to gain legal access to you. Okay? Once they have legal access to you, they will get you to lust. When you fornicate with these spirits, when they get you to lust, that means that they put the seeds in your heart, you think about it in your mind. As far as the Bible's concerned, if you did it, if you thought it, you did it. So they get you to think about it. And they put seeds of lust in your heart, thereby giving you gaining partial legal rights to you. Okay? When you act out that lust, whether you masturbate, which is a sin, or you fornicate, which is a sin, any sex outside of a marriage between a man and woman ordained by God is a sin, or if you fornicate with the spirit, since you're acting on that sin, that will give this entity complete legal rights to you. Complete legal rights to you. Now, you hear rumors that the incubus and the succubus are the same demons. They are not. You do have demons of incubi that also go after males, thus inhibiting the homosexual characteristics. So in other words, you got an incubi spirit that'll go after a male. That's a homosexual spirit, and they will attack the male. You also got succubi are the same as a counterpart. They feed on the energy, the sexual energy of a man. They aim to seduce their victims the same manner via dreams. Both of these beings can appear in a pleasing form to the human eye. They can appear as your dead spouse. They can appear as your loved one. They can appear as your past love. They can appear as an attractive being, an attractive human being that's pleasing to your eye. They have this aura about them. This aura that they give off that's supposed to, it's like a pheromone, a spiritual pheromone that's supposed to seduce the victim and make the victim like under the spell of that incubi or the succubi spirit. Okay. The succubi spirit feeds off the sexual energy of a man. Same thing. It can feed, if a man has too much of an encounter with a succubi spirit, the succubi spirit will eventually lead that man to exhaustion. It can eventually lead to his death if it continues. Because it can be very detrimental and dangerous to your health. Very dangerous. The succubi spirit also aims to plant seeds of lust in the man. Legend has it that she will take his sperm, impregnate herself, and give birth to offspring. Now, succubi spirits, also known as a spiritual spouse. These beings can plant seeds of lust in a man. They can also give birth to spiritual children. I know you're like, what? But yes, I've had people tell me that they had dreams of their spiritual spouse where they're having a wedding, and they had dreams of themselves giving birth. And then, by the time you know it, they were not only tormented by the spiritual spouse, they were also tormented by the demonic spiritual children as well. Actual demons that they were tormented by. I have a video about deliverance from spiritual wife and spiritual husband. I want you to check that out. It goes into greater detail. A succubi is also known as a spiritual wife. It attaches itself to a male victim for so long. Again, they become territorial. They view that victim as their spouse. They will destroy marriages, families, homes. These entities, okay, become extremely territorial. They will go as far as killing anything they see that's in the way of them and their victim. So if the victim is married, if you're not covered by the blood of the Lamb, you are in serious, serious danger, because that demon will try to harm you. Now, an incubus is a bisexual spirit. I know I'm jumping back and forth. I'm trying to make you understand. You getting it? An incubus, like I said, can attack a man. Prefers a woman. There are incubi that prefer both a man or a woman. That's a bisexual spirit. Same thing with the succubi. Succubi, there's those that prefer just a woman, thereby being a lesbian, a spirit of lesbianism. Or they prefer both a man and a woman. You know, a bisexual spirit as well. What else can I tell you? These entities can cause sleep paralysis. I have videos on that. I want you to check that out. They can cause sleep paralysis. Victims say that they're immobile. They can't move. They're choked. They can't breathe. They also say that they hear a buzzing or a beeping sound or growling sound in their ear. The only way for that sound to be removed is if you have to cry out for Jesus, if you can't do it via your mouth. Think of Jesus' name in your head. You make sure that you have faith in the Lord. And you have a strong relationship with the Most High God. Because if you don't, you run the risk that these entities will not respect your authority, thereby putting your life in serious danger. Okay? I'm trying to think of other things because there's some actual testimonies I want to talk to you about that I had to deliver a person from one of these spirits. These spirits will also try to attack a person when they don't even have legal access to them. I've seen that happen as well. That makes it even easier for that individual to be delivered by the blood of the Lamb. It makes it even easier, okay? Because of the fact that if these demons do not have a legal right, then they shouldn't even be afflicting this person or the victim. Now, what I also wanted to tell you about these particular demons is that people, a lot of people get attacked by these incubi and succubi spirits. They get into agreements unknowingly with them, like a demonic contract or binding agreement. And like I said, these demonic agreements come about when you sin. So if you are looking at pornography, if you are lusting, if you have unforgiveness in your heart, if you are sexually active outside of the covenant of marriage, if you are acting in the carnal flesh, you think in the flesh, carnal nature, you think about worldly things, riches, anything contrary to the will of God. If you live in the world, you watch movies, you listen to music, those are openings. Not only are those openings, looking at seductive pictures of celebrities, anyone. The other things that are openings for these demonic beings is looking at porn magazines, listening to worldly music, especially seductive music. Like I said, fornication is a big thing. If you look at any of these items I just mentioned, you are forming an ungodly soul tie to these items as well. If you also are fornicating and you're sleeping with somebody outside of the covenant of marriage, that's a big opening for these spirits to come to you. You're forming an ungodly soul tie with someone that you're having sex with outside of marriage. Those demons that person's dealing with is being transferred to you, and your demons are being transferred to them. I've talked about soul ties before. I want you to check that video out as well. Incubi spirits, like I said before, can take the form of a man, can take the form that's pleasing to your eye. They can even take they're shapeshifters. Succubi spirits takes the form of a woman pleasing to the man. There are a lot of testimonies of widows that their husbands just died. And I was watching this one testimony of a woman that actually wrote a book on this. She said that her husband died, and then he came back to her from the dead, and he started making love to her, and she thinks that that's her husband. So I sent her a message, and I warned her, telling her, that's not your husband, that's a demon. And I told her that that demonic entity is an incubus. That is an incubus spirit she's dealing with, and it's a very dangerous spirit. She's obviously under this thing spell. The minute I sent her that message, I had this foul smell in my house. I have reason to believe, and the Holy Spirit warned me, that the minute I warned her, the incubus spirit that was inflicting her came directly to me to attack me. But when I said a very strong rebuking prayer, the Lord Jesus Christ removed the spirit from my presence immediately. Okay. These spirits have also, I want to let you know something very important that you need to know. These spirits have a very foul smell. The incubus spirit smells like semen. smells like urine, and it smells like a faint, cheap cologne, like Old Spice. The female counterpart, the succubus, smells like vaginal fluid. Smells like someone that they just finished having sex. It smells like urine, and it smells like a cheap female perfume. That's what they smell like. What else can I tell you? Like I said, I'm breaking this down for you guys so you guys can get it. You guys, people are being attacked by these spirits and they don't even know. So this first part here, I'm giving you as much background information as I can give you. And, as much as you need. So that way, if you are experiencing any attacks, any sexual attacks, because there's symptoms that I need to go over with you, you're going to need deliverance. Because these spirits are very dangerous. Very dangerous. Now, I'm going to talk about a succubus a little bit. I know I'm jumping back and forth. I'm trying to get this through to you guys. Okay? Like I said, the incubus spirits will have sex with a woman in order to, and it'll take the form of a man, in order to have sex with that woman. And we'll have sex with that woman in her dreams. But the person thinks that they're having a wet dream or sexual fantasies. But that, like I said, is that what they're dreaming is actually happening in reality. That sexual spirit, that spirit's having sex with them. That's why that person, the woman, wakes up aroused in that area, and most often wakes up extremely wet, like and out of breath, like she just finished having sex. So the succubus takes the form of a woman in order to have intercourse with the man in his dreams. And like I said, these two spirits have sexual or homosexual tendencies, which I already went over with you. What else can I tell you? There are some scriptures that talks about these spirits. Okay, if you look at Proverbs chapter 2 verses 18 and 19, it describes the dangers of a seductive woman, of a strange woman. Strange woman means like a foreign woman. Something ungodly. It warns you of a spirit such as a succubus spirit or any seducing spirit. Okay? If you look at Isaiah chapter 34, verse 14, it says, I'm going to read you a part of it. The screech owl also shall rest there and find for herself a place of rest. This basically warns as well as the resulting judgment with an encounter of such a spirit. So if you are interlocked with one of these spirits, an incubus or succubus spirit, okay, and you are continuously fornicating, and you don't seek deliverance or repent, you are subject to the judgment of God. Okay, some people say that there's some scrolls that talks about how Lilith was the woman in the garden, not Eve, and how she was a seductress, and how the spirit of succubus was inspired by her. That is a pit, life in a pit of hell. Okay. Lilith is an actual demon. It is a vampiric succubus type spirit, but it is not anywhere in the scriptures. In the scriptures, God made Adam, God made Eve. There's no recording of any kind of Lilith. Okay, this Lilith is in other ancient scrolls, which in my eyes, they're nothing but lies. I go by the word of God. Now, you have people wondering if a succubi or incubus spirits are real. Okay? I'm here to tell you that people will write it off as sleep paralysis, your imagination, you have psychological issues. But a succubus spirit and incubus spirits, these are demons that are very, very real. They are mentioned in the Bible. They are very powerful beings, which, I mean, God is the most powerful, straight up, because I don't respect these demons at all. These are powerful entities which have been dealing with mankind since the beginning of time. In 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4, it speaks of angels who sinned and were cast down to hell in judgment. Now, these are angels. This is another example of the Bible referencing about succubi and incubi spirits, because these angels were supposed to be angelic watchers by God, assigned by God to take human form to watch over mankind, but they were not supposed to fornicate with the local women. This is in the book of Genesis, and like I said, 2 Peter talks about it too. They were not supposed to fornicate with women at all. But they did. And as a result, as you know, the Nephilim came about. But these angels that fornicated with the women, they lusted after these women. They gave into the flesh and they lusted. They were driven by a spirit of lust and sexual immorality, sexual fornication, sexual perversion. So that, in a sense, kind of was those angels which fell from earth, and yes, they're demons, they bred the incubi and succubi spirit. So like I said, I'm trying to break this down for you as best as I possibly can, because a lot of people that are attacked by these spirits and they don't even know it. All right. If you look at Jude chapter 6, it speaks of angels who kept not the first estate and are awaiting the last judgment. So it talks about the same thing. Angels that fornicated with women, they were cast out of heaven, they were cast into hell in chains to this day for violating God's laws. Jesus cast demons out of people as his disciples. So Jesus always cast demons out of people, various types of demons, whether it was sickness or sexual immorality, various types of demons. Now, like I told you before, the male counterpart of the succubus is the incubus. It's from the Latin word incubo, or nightmare. It's a demon that supposedly induces nightmares. Succubi does the same thing. They can induce nightmares. If you are submissive to them, the dreams can be pleasant. Even if you are submissive to them, they can give you, the dreams can have like a nightmarish type of element. If you are not, and these are very, and they're very, if you're not submissive to them, they can become violent. Even with the mild attacks, they can become violent if you're not submissive to them. And the nightmares can be, the nightmares or the dreams can become very violent as well. Hope I explained that right, because this is my first time breaking this down for you guys. What else can I tell you? Like I said, I've gone over it before. The male demon, which is the incubus, sleeps with human women. Their aim is to have sexual intercourse with them. They feed off of that sexual energy as their female counterpart does with the man. Incubi were thought to father children, like half human, half offspring, which is called a cambion. That's what legend says. I've yet to come across things like that. I know that these children can be born in the spiritual realm, spiritual offspring. I gave you an example earlier how people said that they've had strange dreams that they were in a wedding. And one woman said that she had a dream that she was pregnant. And then by the time you know it, she was plagued not only by her spiritual spouse, but two other demonic offspring. What else can I tell you? A lot of people take any sleeping phenomenon people get, like wet dreams, they take that as, oh, it's normal to have a sexual wet dream. It's normal to sexually fantasize. It's not normal to do that. It is against God. If you sexually fantasize, you are inviting the lust spirits, not only them, you're inviting all the evil spirits as well. These spirits can tune into your thoughts. You think of lust, you masturbate, you can summon an incubus spirit or a succubus spirit right to your door. These spirits can operate behind various sins. I told you that they can use any sin to gain legal access to you. So if you have a struggle with, let's say, lust or gluttony, like I said before, they can operate behind that spirit as well in order to gain legal entrance to you. All right, I'm going to stop here because there's more that I have to talk about, and I'm going to wait for this broadcast to upload, and I'm going to continue in my second series of Incubus Succubus Spirits Are Real. This version will be part 2. Stay tuned. God bless. Hello, everyone. I'm back for part four. Check out the three prior parts. The way that I set this up is it says Incubus, Succubus, Real, part one, two, three, and four. Parts one and two talks about the Incubus spirit itself, what they're about. The first part talks about what they're about, what do they do, how do they come about. The second one talks about the same thing, but it tells you the symptoms. The third one is testimonies and a little bit more information on these spirits. The fourth one right here is going to be deliverance. So, if you are going through this experience, if you're experiencing an attack from Incubus and Succubus spirits, there is a way out. Assuming you haven't blasphemed Jesus Christ's name, you have a way out. Okay? If you are not a follower of Christ, you have to give your life to Jesus Christ. You have to confess your sins to Him. You have to get baptized, a water baptism. If you're not in Christ at all, you got to get a water baptism, give your life to Jesus Christ. When you do that, then we can start with the deliverance. If you are backslidden or lukewarm, you confess your sins to the Lord. It could be something as simple as this: Jesus Christ, you are my Savior and you died for my sins, and I'm sorry. Please forgive me. I forgive everyone that has ever wronged me, and I ask that you forgive them, and I forgive myself. Please forgive me. Be my Lord and Savior. Come into my heart. Wash me clean of my sins with the blood of the Lamb and set me free. Be my God, be my King, be my Savior. Something as simple as that for a person that is coming to Jesus Christ for the first time, and a person, you know, that person that's coming to Jesus Christ for the first time, get a water baptism, say the repentance, say a sinner's prayer, which I just told you. Person that's repenting of their sins, you can say it as something like You could say something along the same lines of the prayer that I just told you. Confess your sins to God. Renew your faith in God. Renew your walk with Christ. And repent of your sins. Turn away from your sins completely and walk right with the Lord in a way that's pleasing to God. Be righteous in God's eyes. Keep His commandments both in the Old and New Testaments. Okay? Now, with that being said, if you're being afflicted with these spirits, okay, you have to seek deliverance and healing from any past sexual experiences, including any fornication, masturbation, molestation, incest, sodomy, pornography, etc. You have to do a spiritual cleansing in your house very heavily. You got to put away all pornography, fantasies, masturbation, any worldly movies, entertainment, because they can use any of those other outlets to stay, to gain legal access. Because not only can they gain legal access to you, they can gain legal access to your house. Anything in your house can keep them there. That's why I'm very leery. Like, if you go on vacation, right, and you buy an object, it could be a statue, you don't know if that statue has demons attached to it. So you have to be careful. Any worldly books, any worldly movies, music, games, entertainment, anything worldly, you have to get rid of and get it out of your house. That's part of a heavy spiritual cleansing. Okay? Remove any sources of temptation, including any data plans on your cell phone if you must. Anything. Anything that gives you any access to any kind of sin. Stop sinning. Stop abusing others for your own physical desires. Stop giving in to lust. Stop giving in to the flesh. Okay, turn off any form, like I said, of any entertainment that would glorify sexual sin, that would encourage it, that would bring about perversion. We can be inundated with images and sounds that could invite the enemy. You know, you could be going to Walmart and you turn your head, there's a movie clip playing and it has lust in it. Okay, the enemy could try to use that to plant seeds in our head and invite that into our beds and our bodies. You know, invite that into our... They can use that as an excuse to come into our beds and into our bodies, into our homes. Shut it off and keep it out of your spirit, out of your heart, out of your mind, out of your soul.
cease communications with those who welcome these spirits. The Bible says not to associate, you as a believer in Christ should not associate yourself with the wicked, with people that are sinners, that refuse to repent, that have these spirits, that welcome these seducing spirits into their lives through continuous sexual sin. Even living with someone and you're not married outside of the covenant of marriage, that's a sin, okay? Especially those that call themselves Christians that practice these sexual sins, that live with somebody else and they're not married, that watch porn, that engage in worldly things. God says not to be a friend of this world. You know, you got to stay away from them because they're still sinning. Even though they say that they love the Lord and everything like that, but yet they're sinning. They're watching movies. They're listening to worldly music. They're drinking. They're smoking. Engaging in sexual sin. You know, read 1 Corinthians chapter 5. Verse 11 sticks out, but read the whole chapter. You have to repent from all sin, not just sexual sin, all sin. Confess those sins, every confessed sin, every sin has to come out into the open. Confess it. Because if you have even one unconfessed sin, that can keep that incubus or succubus spirit around. This applies to any demon for that matter. Okay? So we confess all sins, repent of those sins, all sexual sins, renounce all sins. If it's a generational spirit that you're dealing with, I told you that in my prior video, I had dealt with a generational lust incubus spirit. In my deliverance, I had to also break the generational ties, the generational curses, and undo what was done, and have the blood of the Lamb go back to my family tree, all the way back to Adam and Eve, to cleanse the bloodline of this lust. Okay? If you are doing that as well, you have to renounce all these sins. You have to renounce, confess all your sins, sexual sin, any sin. Renounce all those sins, all generational sins. Break all generational sins. Break all ungodly soul ties. All ungodly bondages, demonic contracts, binding agreements. All chains, all fetters. All evil fruit. Counterfeit tree. You know, the Lord is the vine. The enemy has a counterfeit vine. Break that. Break these curses, generational curses, ungodly soul ties, past, present, and future. Otherwise, this thing will try to attach itself to your children if you allow it. You have to completely close every demonic door when doing a deliverance. Okay? What else can I tell you guys? There's other things that I have to disclose to you regarding a deliverance. You have to make sure that you anoint your house with olive oil. What I do is I have actual olive oil here. I would usually draw a cross and say a prayer over every house, or I'm sorry, over my doors in my house to give it a spiritual cleansing. I'm very select on what worship music I play, but I play certain worship music. I pray over the worship music because you know that some Christian music is cursed. You know that the enemy's trying to even infiltrate Christian music because they infiltrated the Bible. The only true Bible out there, I have a video out on that, is the KJV version or the NKJV or the authorized version of the KJV. That's it. So you want to say a prayer over any kind of worship music praising Jesus that you listen to undo any evil curses or any spells that may have been placed on it, you know. I told you that before any music is released, the Illuminati likes to have enchantment spells placed on that. These are spells actually conducted by sorcerers. You can do the research yourself. You'd be surprised what you find. They summon demonic entities that place these enchantment spells on the music. When the music's released out, the demons that are attached to this music, the person that's listening to it, the demons would attack that person. So that's why it's good to say prayers, because they even do that to Christian music as well. What else can I say? Like I said, incubi and succubi spirit, also known as spiritual wives, spiritual husbands. They're responsible for breaking marriages. They're responsible for making the woman barren, not able to have kids. I went over that in prior video as well. Now, when you engage and consummate a sexual relationship with one of these entities in a dream, even a dream state, you're actually unknowingly going into a contract with these entities. So, in this case, an unholy matrimonial union ordained by Satan. I know it sounds scary, but I'm just telling you, it's a spirit. If you fornicate with an incubus, okay, some of these incubuses will become territorial and attached to you, thus becoming a spiritual husband, or in the case of a succubus, a spiritual wife. They will attach themselves to you, okay? A lot of people unknowingly enter into these agreements. These demons will try to do these types of agreements in a dream. So what one person may pass off as a wet dream is actually not. Okay? The other thing I wanted to explain to you is that when you are in a situation where an unholy union like this form, in addition to breaking the ungodly soul ties, the strongholds, any connections with these demons, any evil curses, any generational curses, you also have to break these unholy matrimonial unions as well. You could say something like, I divorce you in the name of Jesus Christ, if it is a spiritual spouse or spiritual spouse that is afflicting you. I'm going to leave some prayers to pray against these evil spirits that will help in the deliverance. These are self-deliverance prayers. Okay? Now, going back to what I told you, in addition to doing a spiritual cleansing in your house, so here's the bottom line with deliverance. You have to confess those sins, every sin. You have to repent of them. Prove to God you're going to change. You have to renounce those sins. Then you have to break any ungodly soul ties, strongholds, curses, generational curses, demonic contracts, demonic agreements, binding demonic agreements, chains, any demonic connection. And you have to do this for past, present, and future generations in addition to breaking it off you. You also have to say a prayer of protection when you're moving into the deliverance phase, because after you confess your sins and all of these ungodly connections with the enemy is broken, the enemy's legal rights are broken. Then you say a prayer of protection, asking the Lord Jesus Christ to surround you and your family, your pets, your home, your job, your life, your family, everything in your life with the blood of the Lamb to protect you from any retaliation against the enemy, because yes, sometimes the enemy will try to retaliate against you. You can also put your authority over the enemy to command them that they cannot retaliate against you. Then you proceed into the deliverance prayer, into the deliverance phase. The first part is the enemy's legal rights are broken. All of the sins are confessed. All of the sins are brought to light. The enemy's legal rights are broken. You ask the Lord to put the full armor of God on you, okay? You have the scriptures near you, okay? Because you will need scriptural backing to quote when battling the enemy. So you proceed into the deliverance prayer. Now, I'm going to make sure that I'm giving you every piece of information that I could possibly give you. Before you get into deliverance prayers, when you get to the phase up to deliverance, you have to realize that you have to want the deliverance. I've already told you that. You have to want to be delivered. You have to want help. Okay? You have to realize that there is a problem, that these demonic spirits have made you into a virtual slave. Okay? That you don't want to be under their power, that you want to be back in good standing with God, that you want to be covered by the blood of the Lamb. Okay? Now, incubus spirits and succubus spirits, any perverse spirits in a person's life, they can assume, like I said, the spirit of husband or wife. So, incubus and succubus spirits can assume the role of husband or wife, or thereby spirit wife, spirit husband. So can any other sex spirits. And ladies and gentlemen, there are many sex demons out there. These demons must be renounced. If they play the husband or wife role, they have to be not only be renounced, but they have to be divorced. Okay? They can defile a godly Christian marriage with ungodly, impure fantasy and other perverse things. What else can I tell you? One of the things that Satan will do when a person is being afflicted by one of these spirits, and any demon for that matter, is that they will help them, they will have the victim rationalize their sins, basically saying, if a person's fantasizing, okay, and it's not godly, okay, and they're feeling sexual urges, they'll probably have that person rationalize it by saying, oh, you have a healthy sex drive. When you know in your heart that the sex drive that these entities cause, the sexual urges, are not normal. Okay? A lot of times when a person's afflicted by these demons, they have so much guilt because their body is enjoying the pleasure that these demons are giving them. And they feel guilty and they don't want to tell their spouse. So this leads them down a destructive path of secrecy. Secrecy is where the enemy seeks to unravel the sacred grounds of honesty, the sacred covenant of honesty, trust. It can break down the godly marriage because the enemy wants the person, the victim, to be secretive about what's going on. Because what happens is that if the person's keeping a secret, how can they expect their spouse to trust them? If they're not honest with their spouse, how can they expect their spouse to trust them, their godly spouse, you know, the godly marriage? It can compromise a godly marriage because trust and honesty are crucial for a successful marriage ordained by God. Those are two things, and one of the two most important things, in addition to love, that the enemy is going to try to strip from a godly marriage. Okay? Anytime we try to protect an area that is not right with God, it puts us in a relationship with the enemy. So in other words, the enemy will know you, but not God. Okay? You can be making a covenant with darkness and not even know it. This is a form of spiritual adultery too. So incubi works behind spiritual adultery too, and so do succubus spirits. We can only be loyal to Jesus Christ, not the enemy. What else can I tell you? These entities, like I told you, will use fear to control you. That is one of the biggest attributes that they do. They use fear to control you. A perverse spirit like this will turn things upside down. That, you know, that reminds me of the scripture, woe to those that call good evil and evil good. It reminds me of that scripture. What else can I tell you, you guys? What else? You have to use your authority when you're going through deliverance phases. You have to use your authority against these demonic entities. So when their legal rights are broken, okay, once you confess your sins and godly soul ties broken, strongholds broken, evil connections to this enemy broken, you proceed into the deliverance prayer. When you proceed into the deliverance prayer, you use the authority Jesus Christ gave us as believers. You make sure that you have bold faith and you are not showing 1 ounce of fear to this demon. Otherwise, this demon will not respect your authority and leave. Okay? So you make sure that you have bold faith so it can respect your authority. Now, as I said before, sometimes a deliverance can take more than one session. You also need to have spiritual discernment, super discernment, to decipher if the spirit is present or if it left. and went and respected your authority and went to the pit. The reason why I say this is because in my deliverance session on myself, the deliverance on myself and on that young man I told you about, the spirit went dormant before. Okay? And my discernment was growing, but it went dormant before. And something in my spirit was telling me something's not right here. That demon did not leave. So I went back and did a deliverance session again because this young man was drained. So I had to go back and do the deliverance again because the spirit never left. These demonic entities will go dormant and make you think that they left. They will fool you into thinking that they left. And then when they come back and they manifest again, they manifest with a vengeance to the victim. And then that demonic entity can also turn around and retaliate against those that were involved in the deliverance. So you have to make sure that you have bold faith, you cover with the blood of the Lamb, that you do not back down and you have no fear. And if you are doing a deliverance on someone, you cannot have any sin in your life. You have to be completely confessed of those sins and repentant of those sins. If you are doing a deliverance on yourself, make sure all your sins are out in the open, they're confessed and everything. If you do a deliverance on yourself, you're gonna experience certain manifestations. These manifestations can be they can be very heavy or they can be light. Like sometimes when I was doing a deliverance on myself, I had a manifestation where I had a headache or there was bubbles in my stomach, you know. Other people have reported having convulsions or being flung across the room or things around them moving. So what you have to do in that case is you also have to command, when before you go into deliverance, you have to command, not only do not they retaliate against anyone you know or come in contact with, okay? But you all, and not only saying a protection prayer against you and your family and your loved ones and your finances and everything in your life, you also have to say a prayer commanding these demonic entities commanding these demonic entities that they cannot manifest in any way, shape, or form. You also have to command these entities because these demonic entity will try to sometimes get help from external sources. In other words, there's evil spirits everywhere. So these demonic entities will try to get help and communicate with other spirits outside. You have to forbid this demonic entity from communicating, cut off all communication lines between the spirit inside the victim, the incubus spirit or the succubus spirit inside the victim, or the spirits, between the spirits, let me say it again. You have to cut off communication from the incubus spirit or the succubus spirit that's inside the victim to the communication of with spirits outside of the victim. You also have to command that the Lord Jesus Christ and ask the Lord Jesus Christ to please remove all evil spirits, I say within a 1,000-mile radius. So that way that demon cannot communicate with anyone. Make sure you say, you command the surrounding evil spirits be removed, that the communication lines are cut off between evil spirit inside the victim and the spirits outside the victim, evil spirits outside the victim. So as I told you before, that when these evil incubus and succubus have a sexual encounter with the victim, they deposit more spirits. You also, if the victim has more than one evil spirit, 9 times out of 10 they will, inside of them, in addition to the incubus, you have to also cut off communication from the incubus to the spirit, from the incubus spirit to the other spirits and the subordinate spirits inside. Now, when you are doing it, after you do that, you say the deliverance prayer. Well, let me back up. After you do that, what I just told you, you have to bind up the strong man, which is the dominant personality, the gatekeeper. It is the stronghold that's attracting other demons. That is the lead demon that has a dominant personality, or the stronghold, like I told you before, is like a portal that attracts other subordinate demons. Okay, a stronghold demon will usually try to latch on to any other sin to gain access. Every demon access is like that. Even a subordinate demon can become a stronghold. They can latch on to any sin, become a stronghold, and attract more demons. A person can have multiple strongholds. So you bind You bind the subordinate demons first. You bind the stronghold. No, better yet, let me say it again. You bind the strong man first, and then you bind the subordinate demons as one evil spirit. And then you proceed to the prayer of casting them out. And like I said, make sure that you have boldness. Make sure that you are prayed up. Make sure that you fast. Make sure you are right with God. Otherwise, that demon will not leave you. Okay? Make sure you are right with God. Now, I'm leaving below. I'm going to leave you a bunch of links. Check them out. If you are going through this right now, know that Jesus Christ is the way out. Don't see a witch doctor. Don't see a shaman. Don't put sage in your house. Don't contact a ghost investigator team to your house, because the situation, you're going to make it worse. Because they got demons they're dealing with. They're going to bring it to your house, and you're going to have a whole host of demons. Because you are bringing somebody to your house. You're connecting yourself to that person via a soul tie. Their demons are transferring to your house, and it's making it worse, because Satan can't cast out Satan. I'll give you an example. If you call a witch doctor to your house, and you ask that witch doctor to do a spiritual cleansing on your house, and you have demons in your house, and you got your own personal demons, okay, those demons that witch doctor has is going to transfer. These are spirits of transference. They're going to transfer from that witch doctor to you, and you're going to have a worse problem than you were before. Because Satan can't cast out Satan. So do not contact any witch doctor. Don't get sage in your house. Don't do none of that. Do the spiritual cleansing exactly as I told you. If you need a deliverance minister, you make sure you interview that deliverance minister, because you don't want no one laying hands on you that is dealing with demons themselves, or your problem is going to be a lot worse. My recommendation is to try to do a self-deliverance on yourself. If you are scared, seek out a deliverance prayer. A right one, a reputable one. Seek out one that is right with the Lord. Make sure before they do a deliverance on you that they confess their sins before they even lay hands on you. Because when they lay hands on you, boom, you are forming a soul tie with that person. Okay? Follow these steps. I'm going to leave some information below. If you are going through this, there's a way out, and that way out is Jesus Christ. I hope this four-part series was informative to you. If you want me to add to it, I can. Just message me. This is a two-hour series. I had to break it up into four segments. Check out the other three videos, okay? Know that you are not alone. The Lord will help you. Incubus and Succubus, they do not want you to know this information that I gave you. They don't want you to know that they can manifest as any shape. They don't want you to know that for widows, if you are having sex with your husband and he died, that's an incubus spirit. They don't want the widowers, which are husbands that their wives pass on. If you are having sex with a dead woman, that is not your wife. That is a succubus spirit. Okay? And if you have this demon in your life, you need deliverance and you need to get it out quick. Don't wait on it. Don't let this entity gain strength, because this entity seeks to isolate you, and it's going to feed off your fear. And it's also going to feed off the sexual energy it's gaining from you via sexual contact. Don't let it get out of control. Do not let the attacks continue. If they are attacking you, challenge the attacks right away. So that way you could proceed into deliverance. Okay? You could say something like, incubus spirit, succubus spirit. In the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to leave. My body is the body of the temple. It's the temple of the Holy Spirit. And you are forbidden from touching me. Okay? Don't let these things touch you. Don't let them defile the temple of God. If you are experiencing these attacks, challenge it and get help as soon as possible. God bless.
He goes on to say in his interview, quote, internet pornography has absolutely changed my generation's expectations. What happens when you travel down that pathway for that pleasure is eventually, like all addicts, you have a hard time living in the real world. You have a hard time dealing with real people. Things become obsessive, out of control. And it's because you have conditioned your body and reconditioned your mind in a very deadly, destructive, and dark way. Some of you are hearing this, you know exactly what I'm talking about. It feels like gravity pulls you toward that activity, and you may feel guilty but powerless to stop. It's because of what they call a biochemical love potion is released. There's endorphins and euphoric highs that are quite similar to being on drugs that are released with the pleasure that comes from the ultimate result of the activities that surround pornography. God created sex and the passions and pleasures associated with it for marriage. Because the way God has wired the body and hardwired the brain is that whatever path we go down for the pleasure we receive, we become literally bonded to it, connected to that person or thing. Now, can you see where this would be a magnificent gift for marriage? If you remain pure and you're with your spouse and you love them emotionally, you're committed to them covenantally, you agree with them theologically, you invest in them verbally, and you enjoy them physically, you are habituating yourself, you are conditioning yourself to be bonded to them, to be into them, to be connected to them, to desire them, to be satisfied with them, to long for them. And in marriage, that's wonderful. The qualifications of an elder include being a one-woman man. It says in the English translations, the husband of one wife. But in the Greek, it literally means a one-woman man, that he's into one woman. And his desires are her. His longings are her. His joy is with her. And so the way God has made us, if we obey him, we build this very deep, significant, emotional, mental, spiritual, biochemical connection with our spouse. But if we sin, we then bond ourselves with, connect ourselves to someone or something else. This is where pornography becomes addictive. This is where people become consumed with fetishes. And so God created the body, and he created the passions and pleasures of the body for marriage. And God was very gracious and very wise to give us such a great gift so that we might be one. That's what the Bible says. And when we sin, we do great destruction to our own body, to the hardwiring of our own brain, and to our ability to really enjoy our spouse and to be faithfully devoted to them. And I'll start by doing something that I think is important, and that is defining sexual assault. It comes from this book, Rid of My Disgrace, by Justin and Lindsay Holcomb. He's a pastor here at Mars Hill and runs Resurgence for us. His wife, Lindsay, is also a leader in the church. She's a deacon, and she was a rape crisis clinic case manager. And he taught women's studies at the University of Virginia and is a specialist in sexual assault and domestic violence. And Grace and I actually asked them to write this book because we wanted to have from our church a good Bible-based, Jesus-focused resource to help people who have been sexually assaulted. And we love that book and endorsed it and all of that, and are really honored that that comes from Mars Hill Church. And their definition is any type of sexual behavior or contact where consent is not freely given or obtained and is accomplished through force, intimidation, violence, coercion, manipulation, threat. Hold it right there for a guy's deception or abuse of authority. So that's what we're talking about. It's very important because it used to be that the word rape was used a lot, and it still is, but this is a larger legal clinical definition. And it's important that as you look at your life or your spouse or people you know and love, that you understand what has happened and have the right language. We don't want to falsely accuse anyone. At the same time, we don't want to falsely excuse anyone. And it manifests itself in three ways. The acts can be physical, verbal, or psychological. In the age of bullying and the internet, in the age of certain inappropriate speech and conduct, it just It can be physical contact that connotates sexual assault, but it doesn't necessarily have to be. It also can be verbal and or psychological. And some of you will ask, man, a whole sermon on this? Why is this necessary? I've been to a lot of churches and I've not heard them talk about this. I would say, I love them, but that's their failure. I was talking with a very well-known pastor of a decent-sized church, and he asked this question some years ago of me. He asked, why do you guys talk about sexual assault so much in your church? Well, part of it is, it's my wife's story. Part of it is, as you'll see in a moment, it's epidemic. I said, well, isn't it an issue in your church? And at the time, I think he had 800 people. He said, well, I know of two or three women who've been sexually assaulted, but it's not a big issue at our church. I said, you've not done your homework. You don't know your people. You are ignoring a problem and assuming there isn't one. That means you have a culture in which the people can't be honest about what has been happening to them and get the help that they need. I said, so it's not that you don't have a problem, it's that you're ignorant of a crisis. And really, that's the issue, that sexual assault is an epidemic. It's 1 in 4 women. How many women do you know? 1 in 4. Statistically, the younger they are, the more likely it is. It's also true for 1 in 6 men, and men are highly unlikely to report it for reasons of shame and embarrassment. So it's not just women. 10 to 14% of wives are assaulted by their husbands, which means some women are not only victims, they're married to their abuser, which is a situation I would liken to torment. Abuse is what happens when something is done to you, but you escape. Torment is where it keeps happening to you and you're trapped. For some women, marriage is torment. They live with their abuser. And it wasn't actually until the 70s that the laws even began to recognize marital sexual assault, that it was even a crime for a man to abuse his wife. Assault is also more common in cohabitation than in marriage. And some of you say, that's why I don't want to get married. I just want to live with my boyfriend. A boyfriend is far more likely to sexually assault a girlfriend than a husband is to assault a wife. And here's the staggering statistic. Only 5 to 40% of cases are ever actually reported. Grace's would be an example. It's never been reported, not criminally speaking. So you look at the underreporting. Well, statistically, what that means is a large percentage of women and men who call Mars Hill Church home have been sexually assaulted. What that means is, if it's not part of your story, it is part of the story of someone you know. I mean, how many women do you know? How many men do you know? How many do you know closely and intimately and personally? Well, statistically, you know a lot of victims, and you probably don't know that they're victims because sometimes they don't have the language to understand what has happened to them, or the shame has caused them not to really talk about that. And so at Mars Hill Church, we want to be a place where it's safe for people to be honest about what has happened so that they can get hope and help and healing through Jesus and his people. Number 6, porn is idolatry. 1 Corinthians 10, 7 through 8 says, do not be idolaters as some of them were. And looking back here, he's speaking of an occasion in the history of Israel. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. They ate too much, they drank too much, and they decided that now it would become a very wild night. We must not indulge in sexual immorality as some of them did, and 23,000 fell in a single day. Paul is saying to the church in Corinth, which was an urban church with young people and a very sexualized culture that even had a temple filled with prostitutes in town as part of illicit worship. I wonder if Paul would look at strip clubs today and say, those are temples to pagan gods. It was like that. And he says they were guilty of idolatry. And some of you say, idolatry, I don't even understand what he's talking about. The Ten Commandments begin with these two commandments. First of all, there's one God. And secondly, you're to worship that God alone. And worship of anyone or anything other than the God of the Bible is idolatry. And here's the truth. We're all worshipers. We are passionately giving ourselves away to someone, to something, to a cause, to a person, to an experience, to a pleasure, to a pursuit, to a passion. We give ourselves away. We give our money, our time, our energy. It's what we talk about. It's how our identity is formed. It's what we commit ourselves to. We're all worshipers, Christians, atheists, those who are members of other religions, all are worshipers. The only question is, who or what are you worshiping? And Paul in Romans 1, he makes this very interesting distinction. He says, well, the whole argument from Romans 1:18 through the remainder of the chapter is all about idolatry in regards to sexuality. But he says therein that they exchanged the truth of God for the lie and worshiped and served created things rather than the Creator God who's forever praised. Amen. And he really subdivides all of human history into two categories: those who worship the Creator and enjoy and steward creation, and those who worship the creation as God. And some of you say, well, how do they do that? Paul goes on to say, through all kinds of sexual sin. He talks about heterosexual sexual sin, homosexual sexual sin. He even includes lesbianism, the only express place in the New Testament that addresses that issue. And what he's saying is, if you worship the creation instead of the Creator, you will find yourself being sexually consumed with sinful passions. Because there's nothing more beautiful that God made than the human body. There's nothing more pleasurable that God has given us than the human body. And if you worship created things, you will find yourself becoming perverted. And make no mistake, every time you see an image, lust in your heart, go surfing on the internet, you're worshiping. You're not worshiping the Creator. You're worshiping the created. And it's idolatry. And the issue goes deeper than just sexual orientation or preference. It goes down to the root issue of idolatry. That you can't simultaneously worship Jesus Christ, the Creator God, and be into porn. You can't. You can't worship the Creator while worshiping the created. It's one or the other. So for some of you, your problem is not just behavioral. It's not that you just need to change the way you act. You need to alter the God you worship. There's nothing good that pornography can do for a marriage. Nothing. It's amazing, as Grace and I have done media interviews recently, we've had multiple non-Christian media outlets just flat out ask, are you saying porn doesn't help a marriage? There's nothing good that can come from porn for a marriage? That's exactly what we're saying. And deep in your heart, particularly if you are a Christian, you know this, right? If some guy wanted to marry my daughter and I asked him, what's your plan? And his plan was, I'm gonna look at a lot of porn so I could be close to your daughter. The obvious answer is, you can't come near my daughter. See, sometimes when we're sinners, when we think of what we want, we find a way to rationalize, justify, and excuse our behavior. Start thinking it from the perspective of someone you know, someone you love, brother, sister, friend, son, daughter, and ask, is that what I would want for them? Is that how I would counsel them? No. Then take that counsel for yourself. Porn hurts the viewer or the viewers. It's just like cocaine or heroin. The whole point is get you addicted so that you can give your money to someone else. That's it. It's all about the money. It's always about the money. It's only about the money. The entire industry exists to make you an addict and to take as much money from you as possible. to get you to buy things, to get you to click on websites, to get advertisers to write large checks. Don't be fooled. Porn hurts women. The guy who watches porn and then pressures his girlfriend or wife to do things that he's seen, that harms the woman. I mean, in the industry, women's bodies are pushed beyond the limits of what they can even handle physically. Women are harmed. If you think, I want to do that to my woman, you want to harm her? You want to abuse her? You want to break her? And sometimes women who are enabling, they'll watch, they become addicted. Sometimes they become as aggressive as the men. The result is now we live in a rape culture. I mean, 1 in 4 women is sexually assaulted, raped at some point in their life. For those who are of younger generations, the statistics may even be higher, maybe even 1 out of 3 in a church like the one I pastor. The same is true for 1 in 6 men as well, sexually assaulted at some point in their lifetime. And it's getting younger. There was even a new story that was out this week that says children are now raping children. It hurts the women in the industry. It hurts others outside of the industry who mimic the behavior of those who are being harmed in the industry. See, make no mistake, when they say, oh, it's 2 consenting adults, and the gal's happy, look, she's smiling, and she wants to do it, and who are we to judge? No. Oftentimes, those women were molested as children or sexually assaulted by a boyfriend. They oftentimes self-medicate with drugs or alcohol before they go in for a filming. Oftentimes they're suicidal, they try and take their own life, they go into deep, dark seasons of depression, they have blackouts where sometimes they can't remember whole days of their life as they're psychologically trying to endure the trauma. It hurts people.
I grew up in Florida, Jacksonville, Florida, but when I was 4 years old, was the first time I was molested.
What's interesting is the Bible for thousands of years has said that lust, and that is the entire purpose and point of pornography, is sinful and it's unholy and it's unhelpful. And now modern medicine and science is starting to catch up with the truthful teaching of the Bible. And so biopsychologists and others are studying the effects of pornography on your brain and on your body. And that's because pornography really was, in its current form, it was a massive social experiment. People were uncertain what the results would be, but your generation, your parents' generation, they were essentially the lab rats for the massive experiment. And what we're finding now is that pornography alters the chemistry of the brain. It changes you as a person. One of the leading researchers from the Christian side is William Struthers. He's a Christian biopsychologist. He wrote a very interesting book called Wired for Intimacy. And then he not only looked at what the Bible says, but also what medicine and recent biochemical studies have found. And here were his findings. He said, as we, quote, fall deeper into the mental habit of fixating on these images, the exposure to them creates neural pathways. Like a path is created in the woods with each successive hiker, so do the neural paths set the course for the next time an erotic image is viewed. Over time, these neural paths become wider as they are repeatedly traveled with each exposure to pornography. So here's what he's saying. You desire pleasure and the relief that comes ultimately from activities surrounding pornography, and so you venture down that path so that you might receive that pleasure. Over time, this is how you become addicted, because your body becomes habituated, conditioned to going down that path for that pleasure. It's a neural pathway. You think of it this way. Think of a pristine wilderness where no one has been, except for one path that was frequently hiked upon, and everyone ventured along that path. Eventually, it would be a well-worn rut. So it is in the biopsychology of our brains. If we pursue pleasure down a particular path, over time, a neural pathway, to say it in another way, a rut is created. And our body becomes habituated, conditioned to seeking that pleasure down that pathway. Now, additional biopsychological studies have said that the pleasure that is derived is affecting the same part of the brain and having a very similar response as that of heroin or cocaine. And so, if you've ever known anyone who tried to get off of cocaine or heroin, someone who is deeply addicted to pornography has the same kind of potential struggle, because just like the person who is addicted to cocaine or heroin has created for themselves a neural pathway, they've conditioned their body and reshaped their brain to go down a path for a pleasure, and now it's a well-worn rut, so it is with pornography. That's why you hear people say that they're addicted to porn in the way that some are addicted to cocaine or addicted to heroin. It's that same kind of chemical, biochemical high. And so when people come along and they say, well, you know, two consenting adults, they're having fun, where's the harm? You're literally conditioning your body and re-hardwiring your brain to become addicted to images that you will ultimately prefer over people, such as your spouse, which is the whole point of sex according to the Bible in the context of marriage.